In chapter 2, we learned how to model financial variables when we know their growth rates and proportions. I'm hoping you've already done your assignment for chapter 2. If not, I would recommend that you do that first and then continue.
In the assignment, all the necessary information such as growth rates, the proportions, the changes in basis points were all given to us.
The problem in real life, however, is that nobody will give us these numbers in a platter. Maybe some numbers like interest rates or tax rates, which are dependent on a contract or a statute, may be available, but other numbers are something that we will have to derive on our own. How do we do that? But before we do that, we will have to understand the difference between estimates, forecasts, and projections. What? Do they all sound like synonyms? Well, they are not. Let us understand that first.
Estimation involves identifying the value of an unknown variable using samples, surveys, and or triangulations. To give you an example, let us say a company is budgeting its sales for the next month and it has asked its sales manager to give the data. How does the sales manager get this data? One thing that the sales manager can do is to call up the dealers and get an idea of the quantity they intend to purchase from the company. If the company has too many dealers, then she can call some of the key dealers to get sense of the broad trend. And she can then use that information to quantify the expected sales. What the sales manager is doing here is an estimation. Estimation can be for historical data as well as for future data. For example, Statistics Department of Government tries to figure out how much was the inflation in the previous month using samples and surveys. Similarly, if a company experiences fire accidents in its stores, then it may use estimation techniques to ascertain the losses. As far as future data is concerned, the example that we discussed earlier would be very apt here. When we use estimation techniques to ascertain what can happen in future, what we are doing is also a forecast. Forecast involves ascertaining the future outcomes. It can be done through qualitative approach using samples and surveys like what we discussed earlier. But it can also be done using quantitative techniques such as linear regressions and machine learning. However, to be able to rely completely on quantitative analysis, there are certain preconditions. One is that the foreseeable future environment should remain unchanged and should be comparable to that of past. And the second is that we need to have large amounts of comparable data. What if we do not have large amounts of comparable data? Then it becomes difficult for us to ascertain whether the pattern we see is actually a trend or is it just a random coincidence. When it comes to using quantitative techniques, as on date, the technique is possible in domains such as wealth management, market risk analytics, and credit risk analytics, where we have fairly large amount of historical data. On the other hand, if we were to evaluate certain political risks, such as war, or even the events like Brexit, then it would not be possible to use quantitative techniques because we do not have adequate past data that we can use for comparison purpose. For the same reason, its use in corporate finance is also still not very wide. In corporate finance, business reorganizations, change in business model, changes to operational environment, and more importantly, external factors such as regulations and even the constantly evolving accounting standards makes it difficult to get comparable past information even for companies that have been in existence for long. Let me explain this to you with an example. Let us say a company called ABC LLC implemented artificial intelligence in some of its operational areas and let go some of its human laborers. Now, what this would have resulted is a complete change in the company's cost as well as the cost components. Now, the three-year-old information is of no use in forecasting the future. And with just 2 years of comparable information, we cannot rely entirely on quantitative analytics and we would have to use some amount of qualitative approach. We have discussed estimations and forecasts. Now let us talk about the third one, projection. Projection essentially involves visualizing the future under one or more simulated scenarios. The scenario we simulate can be based on our estimate or quantitative forecast, or they can be completely hypothetical. For instance, a company may want to find out what would happen to its profit if the sales falls by 50%. Keep in mind, it is not that the company is expecting the sales to fall by 50%, but it just wants to understand what could happen in case if such eventualities do occur. This is projection. Now that we have understood what estimation, forecast and projections are, let us get ahead and talk about how do we actually do them. If we are involved in making estimates, we can rely on samples and surveys. As discussed earlier, if we want to forecast sales, maybe we can speak to some dealers of the company and get an idea about their intended future orders. Or we can speak to company management or the industry experts and get their view. Such techniques may work for near term, but it has very little reliability when it comes to long term. On the other hand, if we have adequate comparable past information, we can use quantitative techniques like regression modeling, machine learning and other econometric approaches. But as we discussed earlier, this is largely a visual thinking when it comes to corporate finance, at least as on date. In corporate finance, I term the most commonly used approach as the hybrid approach. In this approach, we use a combination of basic quantitative techniques supplemented by some amount of expert views and personal judgment.
It is the hybrid method that we are going to understand in depth. To understand this method, let me take you back to your school days. Even before you sat for your board exams, you might have had a rough idea about how much you are likely to score in the boards, isn't it? How did you get that? Maybe you looked at your past scores in term exams or the model exams, or for that matter, even your exam scores in the previous grades, right? Same way, when we are trying to estimate a company's future, one thing that we can do is look at its past performance. But what if there are no past performance? I made a similar case to my parents when I was in school. I told them that my school has a very strict standard for correction and therefore my past exam results are not something they should look when it comes to determining my board exam potential. Turns out my parents were smarter. What did they do? They looked at my seniors who scored very similar to me in the school exam and then they looked at their board exam results. With that, they could figure out what my potential was. Thankfully, it's all in the past now. But in companies as well, it can happen. There can be a company which doesn't have a past. Maybe it's a startup. Or some company just wants to ignore the past and they want to do a forecast starting from a zero base. Or maybe things have changed so drastically between the past and now that we think past is not a good indicator at all. In these cases, just like what my parents did with my school exams, what we can do is look at other players in the industry. And through their numbers, we can try to derive what could happen to this company.
Let us now discuss the practical implementation. First, I'll briefly talk about the basic steps. The first step is to identify the appropriate independent variable. Keep in mind, the dependent variable are simply going to be calculated using other variables. We do not have to estimate them. It is the independent variables that need to be estimated. They drive the value of the dependent variables. That is why, in modeling parlance, we call these independent variables also as drivers. If the independent variables are driven by a contract or statute and we also have all the necessary information, then we can directly use the data that is mentioned in the contract or the statute. For instance, interest rates are driven by loan agreement. And if we have access to the necessary information in the loan agreement, we can directly take the interest rate from that. For other cases, we'll have to follow the next three steps. The second step is to calculate the past values if our forecast is based on past behavior of data. On the other hand, if we are using peers as the benchmark, then we will have to ascertain the value of these variables for our peers. The next step is to set the appropriate benchmark. And the last step is to calculate the drift, or what I refer as fine-tuning and adjustment. Let us understand all these four steps in depth using a case study. Here, we have the 5-year income statement summary of PepsiCo Incorporation up to financial year 2018. This is an adjusted financial. If our task is to estimate the profit for 2019, how do we know which are the drivers that need to be forecasted? As we discussed in chapter 2, if you have prior knowledge of what these variables are and how they behave, it would be easy for us to determine these drivers. Otherwise, we will have to identify them through observation of empirical data. One of the key attributes of an independent variable is a certain degree of randomness. Coming back to this case study, this is somewhat similar to the assignment we solved at the end of chapter 2. In the assignment, in order to get profit, we looked at sales and various expenses. So let us try and work on similar lines. Let us look at sales. Sales, we can say, depends on volumes and price. But in case of Pepsi, there are many products with many different measures. Some are measured in pounds, while some in gallons, and some in cases. That makes it difficult for us to come up with a standard unit of volume without breaking down the revenue in terms of different product segments. But for whatever reason, if we are modeling total revenue at company level, then we cannot use this relationship as we do not have standard unit of volume. What do we do? Perhaps we can use the serial relationship. If we look at the past data, we notice that every year the sales just drifts around from its previous year values. So therefore, we can use the serial dependency.
Sales is a large number and it's a continuous variable. So if you're using serial relationship, can you think what's the form of equation that we have to use? And what would be our independent drivers? I'll give you a second to think about it.
In chapter 2, we discussed that for continuous variables, serial dependency is modeling using the form value at time t plus 1 equals value at time t into 1 plus r. Therefore, sales for 2019 should be equal to sales for 2018 into 1 plus r. Sales for 2018 is a known quantity, but the rate of change for 2019 is unknown. Since Pepsi already has past values, we can look at the rates for past years to get a sense of what we should use in future. But how to calculate this rate of change? We know that value at time t plus 1 equals value at time t into 1 plus r. That also means that value at time t plus 1 divided by value at time t, the whole minus 1, should give us the r. So sales for 2018 divided by sales for 2017 minus 1 will give us the rate of change in 2018. Let us use this relationship and calculate the data for 2018. So that would be equal to 64,661 divided by 63,525 minus 1, which is equal to 1.8%. Now why don't you pause the screen and calculate the growth rate for other years as well. So here are the growth rates. Now before we move on to benchmarking and estimation, let us look at some more line items. Let's now look at cost of sales. This expense typically includes expenditure incurred towards raw materials, wages to factory laborers, and other such production related expenses. Most of these expenses will increase if the sales increases. Again, going with what we learned in chapter 2, if cost of sales moves in similar proportion to sales, this creates a multiplicative relationship between sales and cost of sales. If you recollect, multiplicative cross-section relationships are expressed using the form y at time t equals a at time t into b at time t. So in this case, cost of sales is the dependent variable and it depends on sales. And the other variable is the expense ratio, which I'll refer as x. Sales is a dependent variable and it will be calculated. But how do we know what should be the value of x? Again, we can look at the past data. If cost is sales times x, then we can say x should be equal to cost divided by sales. Let us calculate this proportion for 2018. The proportion would be 29,381 divided by 64,661, and that equals 45.4%. Again, I would recommend that you pause the screen now and calculate the proportion for other years as well. So here we have the proportions for all the past years. So far, we saw the independent variables were the growth rates and the proportions. But then, sometimes the entire line item itself can be independent. Let us look at the mark-to-market gain line item here. This represents the profit or loss PepsiCo suffers on account of change in market price of commodity derivative contracts. This line item is random because the underlying commodity prices are generally random in the short run. When we see the data, again we could observe this randomness. In this case, we do not have to calculate anything, especially because this data in itself is independent. Let us recap our approach so far. We looked at three lines: sales, cost of sales, and mark-to-market losses. And for all the three lines, we used theory to identify the underlying independent variable. But what to do if the underlying theory is inconclusive? Let us look at the sales, general, and administration expense. These expenditures would include salary to office staff, rent, marketing expenses, compliance costs, and so on. What are the factors that affect it? At a broad level, there are three factors. One is time. Every year, there may be a gradual increase in salary, rent, and other such expenses on account of inflation factors. Second is scale. As a company becomes bigger, it will need more employees, more space, and more spending on marketing. For a company like Pepsi with international operations, it would also have impact of foreign exchange fluctuations. There may also be few more other factors. If possible, I would like to break the calculations by different factors. But if that is not possible, I will have to use only one. Then how do I know which of the three is a dominant driver? In that case, rather than searching for theory, we can look for statistical relationships. In this case, when I look at the year-over-year growth rate, there are a lot of fluctuations. And we don't have reasons for these fluctuations. But when we see the proportion of sales, general, and administration expenses to sales, or the SG&A expense ratio, we see that it is around a close range with an average of 38.5%. So I know the multiplicative relationship between SG&A and sales is strong. When we are looking for statistical relationships, there are more possible relationships we can look for. For example, in this case, I see another interesting pattern. When the sales growth is negative, the SG&A ratio is increasing. And when the sales is growing, the ratio is falling. With just four data, we do not know if this is really a trend or is it just a coincidence. But if we have large enough sets of data, we can do more such exploratory analysis. Some of the exploratory analysis we can do is to look at change in the change. That is, for example, we can look if there is a trend in the growth rate itself. The second thing we can do is compare levels of two data, which is what we did with our expenses. The other options we have is to look at level of one data versus change in another data, or change in one data versus change in another data, or compare ratio between two data versus the level of one data, or compare change in ratio of one data with change in quantity, and many more such options. But these exploratory analysis would be useful only when we have large set of data.
Great. So we've learned how to identify the drivers and to calculate the past values. What is the next step? Quantitative forecasting method is out of scope for us here, mainly because, as we have been saying, we do not have sufficient large number of past data. The other option for us is qualitative forecast. If you are doing qualitative forecast, the next step is going to be benchmarking. But even before benchmarking, we will have to calibrate the past data, and calibrating is essentially correcting our past data for certain measurement issues. We will discuss this more in detail when we go to financial statement analysis. For now, we'll take the value as it is and we'll proceed with benchmarking.
The main purpose of benchmarking is to establish a basic level for the expected values of independent variables. We have calculated past values for Pepsi, but how do we know which of that should be taken as benchmark? What we take as benchmark broadly depends on three factors. The most important is the objective of the model. Are we looking to get a realistic forecast, or are we trying to do a conservative or aggressive projection? Another factor to consider is whether the variable that we are trying to estimate is impacted by any seasonal or cyclical factors. One more critical factor is the behavior of the data itself. Do they show some strong trend, or are they generally moving in a random manner? If we see a strong trend and we want to do a realistic forecast, then what should we do? When we see a strong trend and if we know that the data has no seasonal impact, then our benchmark should be the latest value. But if the data is affected by seasonal factors, then our benchmark should be the value that was there in the same period in the previous year. So if we are looking at sequential growth rate, we know it is affected by seasonal factors. And hence, our benchmark should be the seasonal growth for the same period in the previous year. On the other hand, if we are looking at year over year growth, it is already adjusted for seasonality. And therefore, our benchmark would be the last reported growth. Sometimes the business may be cyclical and we may be expecting an inflection point. In that case, the ideal benchmark would be the value that was at similar phase in the previous cycle. How do we do benchmark if there is no trend in the data? In that case, a realistic benchmark for the forecast would simply be the arithmetic mean, or in simple terms, the average. Here again, you would have to consider the seasonality and cyclicality factors. But instead of a realistic forecast, our objective may be to get an aggressive projection. In that case, the benchmark would be the most favorable value from the past. So we would go for the highest sales growth or the lowest expense ratio. What to do if our objective is to do a conservative projection? Then the benchmark should be whichever is the least favorable. In other words, we would be taking the lowest sales growth or the highest expense ratio. One of the important points we need to keep in mind is that benchmarking framework need not be same for all variables. It is quite possible and is also encouraged to take different type of benchmarks for different variables. For example, here we see a strong trend in sales growth. If we have qualitative reasons to believe the trend, then our benchmark for sales growth could be the last reported growth rate. On the other hand, if we look at gross margin, we may find that the gross margin is moving in a random manner within a given range. And therefore, the benchmark would be the average. Now let us look at Pepsi and decide on the benchmark. At this juncture, we neither want to be conservative nor aggressive. We try to look for what is more realistic. First, let us look at sales growth. When we see the sales growth rate, we see a consistent improvement over the last 4 years. From minus 5.3%, it has gradually grown up to 1.8%. This could have as well been a mere random coincidence rather than a real trend. But as I look for the reason, I know that in 2015 and 2016, the reported sales declined heavily on account of issues in the Latin American region, which has since then stabilized. That explains this trend. So here, our benchmark would be the latest value, which is 1.8%. On the other hand, when we look at the expense ratios, they appear random. At this juncture, I cannot explain the cause for this fluctuation. Therefore, our benchmark would simply be the average. Let us look at the mark-to-market gain as well. This data is definitely random. So what should be our benchmark? One benchmark could be the empirical average, which is 7.6 in this case. The other option is to use theoretical average, which in this case is 0. A lot of us would prefer that. As far as the difference between theoretical average and empirical average is concerned, we would be learning them in the next chapter. But as of now, we've got our benchmarks. So we have identified the variables, calculated their past values, and have also come up with a benchmark. The last step is to do some fine-tuning and adjustments. In technical terms, we have to calculate the drift. How do we do that? If what we are doing is a projection, then we know it is more hypothetical than being realistic. Here we have quite a few options. One is to simply extrapolate the past trend if we see one. So here we see that the sales is growing and the growth rate itself is steadily increasing. So in our final projection, we may factor in a similar drift. Since the projection is hypothetical, we are really not concerned whether there is actual trend or not. In case if our objective is to be conservative, then we can stick to our conservative benchmark or even adjust it further down. Similarly, if our objective is to be aggressive, we can use our aggressive benchmark or adjust it further upwards. Projections that way are relatively straightforward. On the other hand, if we are doing a forecast, then we need to have sufficient reasons to do any adjustments. Or for that matter, we need to have reasons even if we decide not to do any adjustment. In order to arrive at this adjustment, I recommend that we get answers to four questions. The first question is to know what happened in the past. The second is to know why did it happen. Third is to know whether those reasons are still relevant. And the last question is to know whether anything else has changed. What happened in the past is something that we have already calculated, and therefore we already know the answer. But other questions are not that straightforward.
Answering questions 2 to 4 requires extensive research. In fact, it also requires significant amount of experience to be able to do that. For that reason, we are keeping it outside the scope of this level. But even benchmarking is a good starting point for a model. In fact, what happens in real life is that most of the junior analysts, when they work, they use the benchmark data to build their model, and then they leave it to the senior analyst to do the final fine-tuning and adjustments.
So now let us see how to go ahead with the model for Pepsi based on our benchmarks. We have taken 1.8% as our benchmark for revenue. So revenue forecast for 2019 would be revenue for 2018 into 1 plus 1.8%. For cost of sales, our benchmark is that it would be 45.6% of revenue. We have already derived our 2019 revenue. Therefore, our cost of sales is going to be 2019 revenue into 45.6%. On the same lines, our SG&A forecast for 2019 would be 65,824 multiplied by 38.4%. For mark-to-market gains, we already established a theoretical benchmark of 0, so we'll just use that. We can look at each line item and proceed on similar lines. But for now, we'll stop this case study here. We'll now look at one or more hypothetical case study to understand the concepts we discussed so far. This is a hypothetical case study.
So here we have a company, Coplast, which is a manufacturer of a specific type of plastic containers. What we have also been told is that during the year, there was a regulatory ban on using their container in some food products, and that this is likely to have an adverse impact on its revenue. Two of its competitors have already reported their number for financial year 2019, which ended in June. So our task is to estimate revenue that Coplast will likely report for the same period. First, let us identify the independent drivers. In this case, we have the volume information. So revenue for 2019 can be expressed as volume for 2019 multiplied by price of 2019. Since volume and price are generally drift variables that gradually move around compared to its past, we can model them using rate of change. So our volume for 2019 would be equal to volume for 2018 into 1 plus G, where G is the growth rate. And same way, for price of 2019, it would be price of 2018 into 1 plus G. This growth rate is unknown and we need to benchmark it. But we know that a major regulatory change has occurred this year, and hence benchmarking to the past may not be a good idea. A better thing would be to benchmark to our peers, as we already know their performance. First, let's look at the volume growth. The combined sales of our peers has fallen by around 10%. Could Coplast also move along the lines of its peers? This is where cross-checking with past behavior would be useful. We noticed that Coplast growth rate is not necessarily same as its peers, but it has been moving around in similar manner to that of its peers. And the average growth rate for the company is 4.5%, which is approximately the same for the peers as well. So based on our subjective assessment, we can say that the volume growth of its peers serve as a good benchmark for the company as well. Therefore, we would take our benchmark as minus 10%, which is roughly around the same what the peers have reported.
we can proceed on the same lines for price as well. But the problem is, unlike volume for 2018, price for 2018 is not given. So how do we get that? We know that revenue equals volume multiplied by price. Therefore, we can say that the price should have been equal to revenue by volume. Let us use this formula and calculate the price for the past periods. So the average price for 2018 for Coplast would be 1571 divided by 6.5, which equals to 40.2. On the same lines, we can calculate price for peers as well. Now that we have the price of the peers, let's take the average industry price to see what has happened to it. The average price for the industry has fallen by 14%. So here again, let us look at the past growth rates to see if price of Coplast has moved in line with the peers. We see a story very similar to that of volume. The annual drift has been more or less in line with peers, and the average change at 1.2% is approximately equal to the peer average. So that being the case, we can again take the peer group average as our benchmark. Finally, using this peer benchmark, let us calculate the values. The estimated price for 2019 would be 240.2 multiplied by 1 plus minus 14%, which is 206.6. Our volume was similarly derived using the growth rate and is estimated at 5.9. This gives us a revenue of 1215. So that's it. We are done. In this case, we could have also used one more approach. For instance, instead of taking price as a serially dependent variable or a drift variable, we could have taken it as a variable dependent on the industry average. In that case, price for 2019 would be equal to average industry price multiplied by X. If price is equal to industry average into X, then X should be equal to price divided by industry average. Let us calculate and see if it gives us a strong trend. This value is 72% for 2018, and when we look at the past price, it has almost been around the same range with an average of 72%. So we can use this as our benchmark for X. That means Coplast price for 2019 would be industry average price multiplied by 72%. This again gives us a sales number that's very close to what we had earlier. I hope the discussion we had in this chapter and the exercises we have done so far has given you some idea about how we approach a typical corporate forecasting or projection problem. We can use a similar approach in personal finance as well. Now I would recommend that you solve the chapter end assignments as well to get some more familiarity with the concepts.